my talk is oops, it's corneal perforation. What do I do? So I would like to begin with an interesting clinical case. Is a young male referred coming from Maharashtra. He presented with pain, redness, and watering from his right eye, which started 20 days prior to his presentation to us, which was followed by a similar episode in his left eye 10 days after the first incident. His medical records revealed, interestingly, that he had undergone CXCL 3 years back in his both the eyes. When we examined him, he was extremely photophobic. And after putting adequate amount of local anesthetic drops, only we could put him on a slit lamp light. As you can see here in clinical pictures, in front of you, on your left side, there is his right eye. And on your right side, it is his left eye. The left eye shows that there is a corneal perf with an iris sitting in the perforated area. The glue has already dislodged. And the pupil is also, peaking because of the iris incarceration. You can see a thinned out cornea with a very thin stromal bed and the corneal scarring in the surrounding area. While the right eye, it seems that the glue is still in place, but you can see that the pupil is pear-shaped, suggestive of synecdoche. So it seems that tissue adhesive and bandage contact lens was done locally as an emergency procedure, and he was sent for further management. Evidently, looking at this, he needed bilateral solution. So we were in for double trouble. The decision's dilemmas here would be, should one reapply a tissue adhesive till a good quality tissue is available? What about the other eye? Tissue adhesive was about to get dislodged in that eye as well. If we plan a PK, means optical PK with an optical grade tissue, should we use two tissues from a single donor to reduce the immunogenic load to the person, or do a patch corneal graft with available tissue and later plan an optical graft as a definitive procedure? So what did we do? Eventually, out of these options, we ended up doing this. We decided to, because the tissues were not available, I didn't want to use glycerin preserved tissue. At the same time, we didn't have an optical grade tissue, that too in a pair. So we decided, resorted to using a Tenon's patch graft. And as you can see here in a picture on your right-hand side, a Tenon's tissue is very well placed into the corneal perf. The iris is reposited and the anterior chamber is well formed, and there are overlay sutures onto the Tenon's patch graft. And the second eye also perforated in another 2 to 3 days, and we ended up doing a similar procedure for the other eye as well. With this in background, this case in background, we move on to the main talk. Corneal perforation is an ocular emergency. It can lead to corneal morbidity and profound visual loss, hence needs an immediate management to prevent further complications. It can lead to intraocular infection, leading to endophthalmitis, chronic hypotony leading to choroidal effusion and macular edema, and they can also have secondary glaucoma. Various modalities are used to tackle corneal perforations or impending perforations. One can use tissue adhesive, amniotic membranes, conjunctival tissue, corneal tissue with fresh or, glycerin preserved or scleral tissue for anatomical and functional restoration and to salvage the eye in emergency situations. Recently, Tenon's tissue has also been used to seal perforations in the cornea successfully, as it was shown. Sometimes multi-stage procedures are needed to facilitate visual rehabilitation in such cases. So broadly, if you look at corneal perforations, they can be classified as infectious and non-infectious. Infectious would be bacterial, viral, fungal, or due to any other infections like parasitic infections, while non-infectious cases could be due to neurotrophic, immune-mediated, secondary to Sjogren syndrome, or secondary to RA or other collagen vascular diseases, ocular surface-related, or traumatic. How do we manage these cases? Before we manage these cases and look at the management algorithm, it is important to understand the depth and type and location of the location of the perforation. We must also understand the duration of the perf, status of the surrounding stromal tissue, anterior chamber depth, lens status, posterior segment status, the other eye status, and again, the availability of the tissue. And based on this, our management would be decided. So corneal perforation could be central, paracentral, or peripheral. If it is less than 2 to 3 millimeter with good base, maybe we can go ahead and do away with application of tissue adhesive. If that is not working, or if one wants to try other options, one can use amniotic membrane, either single or multi-layered amniotic membrane. One can even do a Tenon's patch graft as we did in the other case, or a conjunctival graft. If it is larger than 3 millimeter, but lesser than 4 to 5 millimeter with iris prolapse and iris seal, then a multi-layered AMG amniotic membrane or a Tenon's patch graft or one can even resort to Gunderson's conjunctival flap or a pedicle conjunctival flap, or a small corneal or scleral patch graft, which could be either lamellar or full thickness depending on the type of perforation. If it is larger than 5 to 6 millimeter, then one can do a Gunderson's conjunctival flap. People have even tried Tenon's patch graft for even larger perforations of 5 to 6 millimeter in size, and one can even resort to therapeutic tectonic graft, which could be a full thickness tectonic graft. The perforations can present in variety of presentations. Let's look at each modality. The tissue adhesives have been used in ophthalmology to treat various ocular conditions as quick fixes to salvage the eye. Many times we can use it in OPD as a quick fix, and if there is a micro perforation, you can seal it right away on the slit lamp. It can be used as a preparatory procedure prior to definitive surgery. It can be used as an adjunct to sutures for better cosmesis and quicker procedures and recovery for certain other conditions. So two types of tissue adhesives are available, synthetic and biologic. Here we would be essentially talking about synthetic adhesives, that is cyanoacrylate derivatives. These derivatives are compounds with very high tensile strength that rapidly polymerizes on contact with basic substances like water or blood to form a strong bond. As they are synthetic and non-biodegradable, they are usually used on the external surface, as against the fibrin-based derivatives, which can be used under the surface also. They may induce an inflammatory foreign body reaction, including neovascularization and tissue necrosis. They are inexpensive and relatively easily available, and can also be used in OPD directly for quick fixes. So the indications for cyanoacrylate adhesives would be corneal perf, desmatocell, corneal ulcers with significant stromal thinning, peripheral ulcerative keratitis with stromal thinning or perforation prior to therapeutic PK in case of leak, supplement to wound suturing, or at times leaks in case of keratoprosthesis. Here is a corneal perforation where there is an, or it can be used for impending perforation of less than 2 to 3 millimeter in size as seen in the clinical picture. The healing occurs with stromal scarring and vascularization, and at times may not even need another surgical intervention. If we can, you know, fit an RGPCL, and if the vision is reasonably good, they may not need another surgical procedure as well. At times, one may need to repeat the procedure also for these cases. Let's look at the video of how do we apply this tissue adhesive. It's important to create a good base for the tissue adhesive to get adhered to the tissue, so that we deacrylize the surface carefully. As it is a perforated eye, you have to be extremely gentle. You can use a dry Merosil sponge or a 15 number blade gently to deapply the surface. Allow that area to become dry. Take the tissue adhesive into a 1 ml syringe with a 27 or 30 gauge needle, and you can form a small drop and apply a small quantity onto the surface. If you need to reinforce, you can again reapply and wait for the tissue, glue to solidify, and then apply a bandage contact lens onto the surface, as you can see here in this. A modified version of this technique, as described by Khalifa et al., they describe that one can use plastic drape over the perforation site and apply a cyanoacrylate glue, which will prevent the glue from entering into the anterior chamber. So clinical pearls we already discussed. Only thing is, like, if there is a flat AC, you can even form the AC with 30 gauge needle and remove a wire speculum carefully without disturbing the glue from the surface area. The post-procedure care would include, you know, because the BCL would be there, it is mandatory that you put this patient on antibiotic drops for some maintenance dose. A BCL may need change at 4 to 6 weeks. They require frequent follow-ups, and if the surface is healed by 6 to 8 weeks or a little more time, either the glue may dislodge or on its own, or you can lift it up with forceps in OPD or on a slit lamp. Sometimes one can face complications like early dislodgement, and you may have to repeat the procedure. It may, like, you know, if you apply a lot of glue onto the surface, it can end up into irregular, bumpy or spiky surface, and that can lead to giant papilla formation or sometimes bleed from the tarsal conjunctiva. A recurrent dislodgement would warrant the graft or other procedures, and sometimes glue has entered into the anterior chamber can cause severe inflammation. So tissue adhesive can work as quick fix in OPD and operating rooms for many surgical procedures. One needs to be oriented to the procedure and selection of the patients to achieve optimum results. One can also resort to conjunctival flaps for corneal perforations. The downside here would be one needs to do a lot of dissection of the conjunctiva. It would obscure the cornea postoperatively for viewing, And they promote extensive corneal vascularization, which would facilitate corneal healing, but simultaneously would increase the risk of graft rejection if one requires to you, I mean, do a corneal transplant at a later date. One can use amniotic membrane transplant, either a single layer or multi-layer. You can use multiple layers in the form of sandwiches, and on top of it, a huge, large layer of amniotic membrane is sutured.
Dr. Paras, you've exceeded our time.
I'll just move fast. So,
thank you so much, ma'am.
Shall I
continue?
The advantages of using Tenens tissue are many. It is available easily and in abundance. There is no need to donor, no need for donor cornea. Hence, it eliminates the risk of disease transmission as it is autologous. It works as a volume replacement, or it can fit any shape. It is repeatable. Being avascular tissue does not increase the risk of immunological rejection for penetrating keratoplasty in future. This is a case similar to what I had shown earlier. This was a patient of RA who ended up with corneal perforation. You can see a previous patch graft in that, and there is an iris prolapse. And this is a surgical procedure of Tenens patch graft. You can harvest a tissue, a Tenens tissue from here. We are doing, taking it from the supranasal area of the eye, and sufficient amount of Tenens is taken. You can remove the necrotic tissue from the corneal surface, do a sinoculysis, form the anterior chamber with a small air bubble, and stuff this tissue into the corneal perf gently so that some amount of the tissue stays inside and some amount stays outside. And putting some amount of fibrin glue to allow the tissue to remain adherent to each other. And then I'm applying overlay sutures with tenonylon to secure the Tenens patch graft into its position. So this is a post-operative result at 1 month. Professor Rasik Vajpayee and Dr. Namrata Sharma had popularized this technique, tuck-in tenon patch graft at corneal perforation. It was a retrospective case series wherein they, 31 cases were treated with Tenens graft. They used technique of tucking the Tenens tissue in a peripheral stromal pocket created at the edges of the corneal perf to prevent development of adherent leucoma. And it also used sutures to secure the Tenens. And it yielded almost, 82.7% success rate. The other group which published a similar results where, interestingly, they used tissue adhesive along with Tenens. They did not use overlay sutures in this series, and you can see that there were a lot of problems of adherence of the tissues to the wound. So the success rate was less, 74.1%. Recently, a published report from L.V. Prasada Institute, Dr. Sayan Basu and group, published 4-year results of Tenens patch graft in a patient. This was done in a perforation due to herpes zoster ophthalmicus. They did follow up this patient with serial high-resolution ASOCT imaging. Subsequently, he underwent a cataract surgery. So this particular case demonstrates remodeling capacity of cornea and tensile strength of the tissue post-Tenens patch graft. So Tenens patch graft is inexpensive, easily accessible, and surgical technique is easy with only sutures. It is effective in sealing large perforations up to 6 mm in diameter. It integrates well into the host cornea and serves as a effort for the also eliminates risk of disease transmission and dependency on eye banks. It harbors autologous fibroblasts that aids in its integration into the host cornea, and it can allow possibility of corneal transplant with better outcomes. I'll just run through the pictures. These are the patch grafts, various types of patch grafts done for larger perforations. And it is important that many a times you can do away with just the medical management. This was a case of immune corneal melt referred for therapeutic patch graft. Just a medical management resolved the corneal perforation. So not all corneal perforations would need a surgical intervention. So to summarize, each case of corneal perforation needs careful assessment for management strategy based on underlying etiology, location, and size of perforation, tissue availability, and the status of the other eye. One can do a temporizing procedure with goals of successful long-term outcome for the more definitive procedure. Thank you for the time, and thank you for accommodating the long talk. Thanks a lot.